Baden, Austria, once home of Ludwig van Beethoven, and this week, home to the cream of world poker and the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. Baden is always a popular leg on the EPT, and this time round, 282 players entered.
Favorite EPT.
Each paying 8,000 euros to create a prize pool of 2.1 million euros. And that really is music to the players' ears. Yes, we've already waved goodbye to many an EPT favourite. Only 40 players remain as we start our coverage, including August Betts, Hervad Khan, and Philip Ye, to name but three. And we've got some great names at our first feature table. 40 players in total. And under the cameras, under the lights, Alan Smurfit. And that, sitting in front of his chips,
He's
is a
everywhere.
World Series bracelet, which he picked up in Las Vegas over the summer. Julian Thu from England. They call him Yo-Yo because his chips are always going up and down.
See, that's how sick he is.
Surinder Sunar very nearly made the final table in London this season.
White shirt.
And we have an EPT champion at our feature table. This man, Pascal Triple P Perot.
And so chapter 3 of season 4 of the European Poker Tour begins. And analysing the action here in Baden alongside me is Norwegian poker pro Sverre Sundbo.
Hello.
An interesting mix of players on our feature table.
I think it's a great feature table. You're sitting here with Surinder Sunar. He's a pretty solid player, but he's creative. You got Pascal Perot. He's a very, what can I say, tight, aggressive player. He plays tight, then he loosens up and he starts firing. Julian Thu, he's not known as Yo-Yo for anything. That guy can go up and down, and he's really, really loose. But he's aggressive. He's good. And you also got the last player here, Smurfit, who won himself a World Series bracelet this year. He's tight. He's really tight. So I hope he can actually manage to break through this table without just having to catch hands.
Should be some interesting action, so let's get straight to the table.
It's 1,000, the big blind is 2,000.
Calling the action here in Baden, it's James Hartigan and Sverre Sundbo. Blinds at 1,000, 2,000 with a running ante of 200.
And it's funny, we see Surinder Sunar sitting here in the top 40 so often, but he's always short stacked. Once again, he sits here with 39,000 right now.
Well, this guy's got more than average in chips. This is Vladimir Polchuk from Russia. Not going to play this hand. Some pass round to Alan Smurfit.
Well, Smurfit right now is sitting with about 50,000 in chips and he's picked up aces.
And he's just called.
Well, there's a reason behind that, because if you were to look a little further down the table, you would see an Italian, Carlo Lorenzo, who has almost no chips and is sitting in the blinds right now.
Well, Pascal Perot has limped as well with the pocket nines, and action is now on the short stack. Carlo Lorenzo, and the Italian pushes all in. Great news for Alan Smurfit.
And I think that was a part of Smurfit's plan the whole time. He knew that if he limped and someone else tagged along, it would be too much of a temptation to resist here for Lorenzo. Well, Smurfit has 50,000 total.
Is he going to come over the top now to try and get Pascal out of the pot?
That's what I'm thinking, because Pascal has like 100,000. He may just flat call here. He knows that Perot is not going to stick around most likely, but he's trying to figure out what to do, and he's going all in.
He comes over the top.
Re-raise all in.
With two players all in front of him, Pascal Perot will probably realize the nines are no good.
Yeah,
no, I don't have any. If you didn't do that, I would have called him. Now I'm going to pass.
Thank you.
Yeah, but Perot was begging for a flop here.
I got pocket aces.
He would love to try to make a set
first
on the flop. We're heads up, and Carlo Lorenzo's just seen the bad news. His king 10 is in terrible shape against the pocket aces of Alan Smurfit. And the Italian's at risk.
These are the ones I lose all the time. It's only about 50-50.
He's actually asking for a miracle right now.
Well, it's not 50-50, Alan. You're an 86% favorite.
Nine. And there's Pascal's nine.
Oh.
So what Pascal is kicking Lorenzo right now. Why couldn't I have seen this flop? Well, Lorenzo is going to need a queen right now to stay alive.
That would make him a straight.
Is a seven. Or an eight.
No queen. So, an eight or a queen to stay in the tournament.
Is a ten.
The ten
so
is a blank.
First player at
a single pair for Lorenzo, lower than the aces of Alan Smurfit. They hold up. They didn't get cracked this time, Alan.
It's never easy, is it?
Well, they did by Pascal, if you can consider that Lorenzo actually saved him right now. But that was his plan, and he got away with it.
Shoulda, woulda, coulda. He didn't stay in the hand. He didn't win. It's Alan Smurfit who took the chips of this man, Carlo Lorenzo.
He can make three nines if he calls.
It's better with him.
Okay, anyway, thank you. Okay. Bye.
Here's the tournament leaderboard right now. It's not often you see a Swiss player at the top of the table. Even rarer to see two. Anton Alleman and Asa Maslam are the chip leaders right now. A couple of names from our feature table, Vladimir Polshuk and Julian Thu. And there is Mr. Alleman.
He looks like a rock and roll star, no poker player.
I was going to say, looks like a goth. I didn't know they had those in Switzerland.
Well, if it's good enough for Ludwig, then I guess it's good enough for us here as well. Beethoven was obviously inspired by this beautiful spa town. But the real question is, will our few remaining players be similarly inspired to go on and win the gold? I guess they're just going to have to compose themselves. 16 players are going to have to go out before everyone's getting paid. That means in 24th place, you take home just shy of 13,000 euro. But not everyone wants that, oh no. They're going for the top prize, and that's 670,000 euros.
Not a bad payday. Blinds are posted, cards are in the air. And action is on Alan Smurfit. I wish you'd put that bracelet away. Stop showing off, man. Pocket eights.
How much is it, 2,000?
Oh, he uses it as a card cap.
Five.
Alan raises to 5,000.
Well, Julian, you usually know that when Alan Smurfit comes in for a raise, he has something. He, especially as of late, it seems he's tightened up a lot in his play, and he's usually quite sincere when he chooses to play a hand. And this time, pocket eight's pretty good starting hand.
It's been folded round to Surinder Sunay, sitting on the button with Jack six, and Surinder quite a solid player, quite a tight player. That's not the kind of hand he gets involved with.
Folds.
So the big blind.
Harald in the big blind.
Harald Puskel. He's a local boy.
All in.
Nonsense, all in.
He comes over the top with king, queen.
Well, it's an exact coin flip situation here if Smurfit decides to call. And based on that chip stack, it seems as though you may have to hear Smurfit.
23,200 to call.
We've seen Alan Smurfit in these situations before, though. He likes to be the player moving all in. He doesn't like to call all in, even when it's not for all of his chips.
So the raise is 28,200.
28,200.
Well, king queen is a nice hand to push with. It's not a hand to be calling with, and Pascal, I think, makes a good move here because the only hands he's really scared of is pair queens or higher or ace king, ace queen. It's been raised from late normal position here, and it's good to push. And you see Smurfit is having trouble right now, too. But you don't like sitting there with king queen, waiting for someone to maybe call you down.
22. 20.
We know the correct decision would be to call, but he's got to be worried about a higher pair, nines and upwards.
Ooh, maybe next time.
Maybe this time. Haven't decided yet. I don't, how much time do I have?
I didn't. They put him on the clock minute. Yet, have they? Oh, now they have. They're giving him a minute warning.
This could be my tournament.
He does not look like a man who wants a call right now.
He's looked back at his hand, a sure sign that they're going to go in the muck. He's let it go.
Well, he only invested 5,000. He got away from it.
Would you have done it? He tempted him.
Telling everyone what he had and asking for their advice.
This is how to work it with a World Series of Poker bracelet.
No, I'd say 60-70. It would be down to 30 if I lose it.
Right, okay, then it's quite a big call, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, it's, yeah.
Well, you need to make calls like that if you're going to win a tournament. Welcome back to day three in Baden. We've already had some exits. Havad Khan, the last remaining Team PokerStars member, is out in 38th. Logic dictates 37 players remain. Back to the action at our feature table. Blinds now 1200 and 2400, running ante of 300. Forcing the action, forcing the short stacks to get busy.
Seat number one.
Well, Alan Smurfit is the one to act here, and he's probably still regretting that fold he made with the eights earlier. At least he was asking for input of all the other players on the table.
Yeah, Alan acknowledges that he's really a keen amateur, and he's always keen to learn from the pros, people like Julian Thu.
Well,
raising here with 6-2 of clubs.
This is a play I like. This is the kind of play where you pick up some blinds and antes, or you have a decent hand to fall back on. Who's going to expect you to sit there down with a suited semi connector down there?
Yeah, you like it because you're a crazy Scandinavian. Well, we Brits can't get away with this kind of thing.
Surrender folds.
Well, that's because you don't get the ace six deuce flops.
Actions on Vladimir Polshuk of Russia.
Vladimir folds.
And he gives up the blind, and so Julian wins that one uncontested. It worked.
Well, he's sitting there just kind of nicking a little bit, and if you don't have the cards, you have to make something happen before you get critically short.
Julian Thu knows a lot about tournament poker. He's been playing professionally for 2 years now. He's actually been playing the game, though, since 1999. He hails from Nottingham. He used to be a draftsman. He's actually cashed 6 times on the EPT over the course of the last 3 seasons, making 2 final tables in the process. And that means he's racked up a few points on this, the EPT rankings board. This is a true measure of poker skill. These points are worked out by where players finish in a tournament, depending on how much prize money's at stake, how many entrants there have been. And as we can see, Rambaswani is top of the table. Mark Telcher second after taking an EPT title and finishing second in Barcelona this season. Action on the outer tables as we edge ever closer to the money. Dutchman Victor Goossens taking out Matthew Tyler. 12 more to lose before we're in the money, before the bubble bursts.
And what was real interesting to see by that fact about Julian Thu is his biggest win is in the $80,000 range. And he's been playing every tournament you can imagine on the European Tour lately, and he always seems to be high up there.
It's all about consistency.
Wait.
Oh, seems to have been some problem with Pascal Perrault's cards here.
Oh, yeah, it's a good one. Oh, it feels good.
It's heavy.
Every now and then they get stuck under the rail.
Michael folds.
Michael Dürer Pascal of Germany folds. Has folded. Pascal also passing. Surrender, ace jack. Now, surely, even Surrender Sunar will play that.
He's having a bit of a hard time stacking up here, but it seems like he's putting in a bet at least.
And what do you read from a player when they fondle their chips like that and they go everywhere?
From Surrender, nothing. Surrender usually has a solid hand when it comes into play.
Vladimir and Harald fold. Ellen, seat number one.
And Smurfit's got pocket sixes.
Folds.
Well, if he's going to lay down eights, he's going to lay down sixes.
Well, Julian Thu is a player who knows Surrender Sunar well, and he knows that Surrender is going to fold a lot of hands here, though.
Julian calls in the big blind, so we see a flop.
Flat call. Julian Thu slightly ahead as we go to the flop. But there's the jack for Surrender.
Let's check 10-4 rainbow. Julian checks.
And Surrender hand just went from scary to beautiful.
Surrender bets.
Nearly half the pot, just under 10,000. with two overcards on that board and a bet coming from a solid player like Surrender, Julian surely has to throw this away.
But he looks so tempted. Look at his face. He looks like, if did Surrender really hit this now? And if he didn't, he's going to fold. He's going to fold a 10, he's going to fold a 4, he's going to fold a pair. I can push him off, this is thinking.
It'll be payday for Surrender if Julian did decide to make a move. I guarantee you he's not going to lay this hand down. He's got top pair, top kicker.
Julian raises.
And Julian has raised.
20,000 more.
Is it time for Surrender to push?
Yes. Surrender is a short stack. He's got top pair, top kicker. Surrender Snar is going to push all in here, I think. And Julian Thu is going to have invested so much he has to call this.
Yeah, he'll be committed to the pot.
I mean, there is the odd chance that Sunar could be sitting with king, queen, or something like that here now, you know?
Surrender calls.
That was a very strange move. He flat calls, leaving himself just a stack of hundreds.
You see the turn card?
And the eight falls on the turn. This is unbelievable. Julian Thu makes a really bad play, and he gets rewarded.
Well, now they are all in. Julian Thu just betting enough to put Surrender's remaining few chips into the middle, and Surrender sees that he was ahead on the flop. Julian Thu catching a lucky card on the turn, Surrender drawing dead, and he is out of this tournament.
And he looks disgusted. He looks absolutely disgusted.
Surrender is an experienced enough player to have taken many a bad beat, to have seen things like that happen all the time. Julian's a bit embarrassed about it, though. Hey, don't complain. Any pot one is a good pot.
Well, you still feel more guilty when you take pots on very poor plays where you're miles behind them when you actually make a good play and you can win some chips.
I played it well when I hit the set, that's about it.
Well, Julian Thu said it himself. He played the hand pretty badly, but got very lucky when he needed to.
He didn't just play that badly, he played it awful.
Don't mince your words, will you?
Well, I mean, what he's doing is Surrender is putting in a bet saying that if I don't have a part of this, sure, I may fold it, but you have to invest even more and it's gonna be expensive for you, and I will most likely call you with absolutely anything here, even if I have something. He has top pair, top kicker. Poor play, Julian Thu.
I'm gonna ask you a question. I want you to be honest. In a tournament, would you rather be good or would you rather be lucky?
I wanna be so lucky.
Unfortunately, Surrender Sunar was not so lucky.
As Surrender well knows, sometimes you can do everything right and poker still doesn't like you. Are you feeling a little bit hurt at the moment from that?
No, it's just another tournament. These things happen in poker. It wouldn't be exciting if these things never happened.
That's true. It's what makes it interesting and new. What do you think of Julian's play there, though?
Well, I was surprised that he moved in on me on the flop, because he must know, because I made a big bet on the flop, so for him to... You know, he must have thought I had ace-king or no hand.
So it wouldn't change the way that you played it at all then?
No, but I'm really surprised he moved in on me, but, you know, good luck to the guy.
Who do you think might win this then?
Well, I think Julian's got a good chance. You know, he's a good player and he's got good chips now.
Well, I guess we have to see who poker does like.
I know when you're sitting at a poker table, you're meant to hide your emotions, but Surrender Sunar hides his emotions all the time, even when he's out of the tournament.
Well, he tends to get that three-second look of disgust when something like that happens, and then after that, he shakes your hand, and he's a very, very good sport. And it's nice to see some people with gamemanship still in this game.
Andreas folds. Small blind Alan, big blind Julian.
Action's been folded around Alan Smurfit. And I think he's just going to call
Alan
from the small blind.
1,200.
And Julian Thu has picked up ace-jack, and he says raise.
Julian raises.
Brown chips means 5,000 more.
Looks like we've got a new player arriving at the table, replacing Surrender Sunar. It's Alex Kravchenko, so we've now got two Russians on our feature table.
I promised myself I wouldn't live. I promised myself I wouldn't live, and I just did. It's a formula for the disaster.
You're going to get to see it anyway.
What?
You're going to get to see it. Even if I'm bluffing you, you're going to get to see it.
You're not bluffing too much. It's not like I'm considering a serious raise.
Well, pass quickly and I'll show you quickly.
All right, I'll pass quickly then.
Can't let you see a free flop, can I?
and folds, and Julian wins the pot.
If Alan Smurfit hadn't lived, if he tried to raise Julian, he would have been re-raised there without a question.
Absolutely.
Two new players.
Well, here's what he looks like from the front. It's Alex Kravchenko, the first and only Russian to have won a World Series of Poker bracelet, and another new player at our feature table. This is Anton Alleman. He used to be the chip leader. He is no more. Maybe someone could have told him he'd be on TV today, and he might have made an effort.
Seat number one.
Well, Kravchenko at least didn't bring his World Series of Poker bracelet to hold his cards here, but Smurfit is still growing strong.
Maybe he thinks it's intimidating people. It's not working, Alan!
Michael folds.
Pascal Perrault has been surprisingly quiet here, the talkative Frenchman who usually makes quite a big scene at every table he sits at.
He's just arrived at the table.
Alex folds.
Alex Kravchenko is going to sit this one out. Whereas Anton Alleman with ace four in late position is going to get involved, raise it up to 7,500.
And there's something weird. Every time a new player sits down at a table, that player wants to raise the first hand almost every time.
Vladimir folds.
And that
Harald announces all in.
Is something that Pascal seems to have picked up on with king five.
He moves all in. Now, has he got enough to make Anton pass?
I say absolutely. He needs to call almost 30,000 more out of a total of about 100. He can't call here. He's got a bad ace, a really weak ace, and he doesn't punish any kind of hand.
Call.
And he calls. Wow.
And he didn't really take that long to think about
it. Call.
Well, it looks simple for those watching the cards here.
Chances are you have to bet a hand, but...
Well, the chance are he does, but actually he doesn't, and... Pascal's going to be really embarrassed when he shows the king five.
You know, I think he's just going to be mesmerized by how it's possible to make such a beyond comprehension sick call.
Well, maybe he likes to gamble.
No, it's a call.
So you know he looks like a genius.
Yeah, I need a call.
I know you played with him before, so...
Ah, that read on him.
That's information.
I mean, it's not that I like flipping again.
Held Pascal's case here.
Good luck.
But as you can see, he was lucky with what he's facing. He's actually a 64% favorite right now. And that's not often with ace four. And right now he's hit a pair, but it doesn't help him much because a king or a five would keep Pascal alive.
And he needs to hit that king or five on the river or he's out of this tournament. He misses. And so Anton Alleman, having made that incredible
good
call,
game.
Knocks out Harold Pascal.
And right now Alleman has made a pretty clear statement. Do not mess with me. I look scary, and I am scary.
He's also working up a bit of a schvitz. On the outer table is a true legend of the game. It's Tor Hansen.
A true godfather of poker in Norway, and he has taught every young, crazy Scandinavian you see right now. And the weirdest part of it all, he's a tight player.
Just been knocked out by David Solin, and that means we have 30 players left.
And this is the point of the tournament where you can actually see the light at the end of the tunnel.
Well, you can see the money.
You can see the money Ellen. In the bottom of the bag.
Alan Smurfit has a queen and a four. He's not going to play that.
Very methodical how he looks at his cards, isn't it?
No matter how many times you look at them, Alan, they're not going to change. They're no good. Throw them away.
Well, and one person that doesn't need to look is Julian Thu, but he has a hand this time. Nines.
Oh. Ace-King in the hands of Michael Durra.
9,000.
Let's just say this. We got action. It's always nice to have that cell phone in the middle of your thought process, isn't it?
Whatever happened to Ring Ring? Why do people have to have these irritating downloaded ringtones? Well, he's not going to let it get to him. I think we're going to see a big re-raise here.
Michael Durra re-raises to
36,000. Still more players to act behind, including Alex Kravchenko with pocket sixes. But against a raise and a re-raise, that's the right move, isn't it?
Yeah, it's he may have been thinking a second about how about bluffing back one more time, but he decided not to. And here's Jax. This is working out to be a very interesting pot. But a lot of people would fold Jax after a raise and a re-raise from early position as well. Quite easily, in fact.
Vladimir Polshuk showing the jacks as well. That's poor etiquette, isn't it? To show the players to your side what you've folded?
Well, it's something to get away with. It's he's just saying, look at me, I'm tight and undisciplined.
So action's back on Julian Thu. He was the original raiser.
And Julian is the kind of player who I believe could decide to push back here at Durr. There's no option of calling. He cannot call this bet. He either has to push or he has to fold. And he folds.
Julian folds.
A sensible decision?
Absolutely. Right now, Durr had to have a solid hand. There's only one solid hand that's not a pair, and that's ace-king.
A hand you can learn something from if you're watching at home. More action to follow after this short break here on the EPT. We're in Baden.
Welcome back to Casino Baden, where the EPT has seen two very different kinds of winners so far. In Season 2, we had Patrick Antonius, the cool, calm, collected Finn. And who can forget last year in Tang Duk Win's jubilant victory dance? But then you'd be pretty happy, too, if you just won nearly €500,000. And this year, there's even more honey in that pot.
I think my favourite story about the first ever tournament here was that Patrick Antonius turned up late. Half his stack had actually been anteed away, and he went on to win it!
Patrick Antonius broke through after that win in Baden on the tournament scene, and he just went on to just rip apart Europe and then go to the States and start ripping it apart there as well.
Well, look what they're playing for this year. We're getting closer and closer to the money. Of course, the big payouts are when we get to the final table. And we're looking at a first prize this year in Baden of €670,000. Jack Queen. Michael Durr. He's made the short trip across the border to be here in Baden. As the first player to speak in this pot, I think he's counting out a raise.
Some players are so methodical when it comes to their raising structures and me, myself, tend to play rather fast, and those players actually manage to somehow tilt me if they spend forever, every time they make a decision.
Pascal has exactly the same hand and folds. That's the difference, isn't it, between being the first one to speak and then facing a raise?
It's so much easier to just go out there and put in the bets before people do anything. I mean, just take it into consideration later for all the new players starting now. It's easier to bet than to call. Always be the better.
Sitting in a small blind.
I think it's
Jack 10.
But the rules don't apply if you're Russian.
Alex Kravchenko has money already invested. He doesn't believe Michael Durr's raise from late position, so he's going to re-raise.
Well, he actually followed the rule of thumb. Be the racer.
And now it's a tough situation for Michael.
No, it's not. It's an easy fold. It's a good play by Kravchenko, in my opinion, and Durr should here fold. Well, I mean, we're looking at cards. He shouldn't, but the way...
How much have you got wrong about? 100 or something?
Normal poker player thinks.
What does that noise portend?
Maybe he wants to be the racer one more time and push all in.
That would be a phenomenal move.
Well, it would be the steal, re-steal, re-re-steal play.
No, he decides to be sensible.
Michael finally no passes. Guts, no glory, and Kravchenko walks away with a rather nice pot here. He was pretty short stacked, as you can see.
Alex was a businessman back in Russia before he became a poker pro. We've already mentioned that World Series bracelet. He's had some big wins in Europe as well. In fact, his tournament winnings exceed $2.4 million.
Okay.
Now, what's worse than going out on the bubble? A slow death on the bubble. Here we see Haimo Kraner all in preflop with ace-queen. David Solin and August Spetz have both called. So we've got three-way action. And David Sonlin has hit a set of eights on the river. And that means he has won the pot and he has eliminated Haimo Craner. And that means everyone else is getting paid, hence the smiles.
Last river, sir, two out of the game. If it was a split pot.
And with 24 players remaining, it's time to shuffle the players and redraw the tables. There's tournament director, Edgar Stuckley. And obviously that means we're going to have a brand new feature table. We'll meet the players in a moment, but let's have a look who are the chip leaders right now. After winning that pot, David Sonlin of Sweden has the most, 375,000. 219,000 is Sebastian Ruthenberg of Germany, and Dennis Kalo of Hungary has 208,000. So let's meet the players at our new feature table. And if you were watching the EPT last season, a few familiar faces for you, including this man, Andreas Højvold, who won the title in Dortmund. In seat six, Sebastian Ruthenberg, as we just saw, one of the chip leaders in this tournament. And Gunnar Rabe of Sweden. So what do these three players all have in common? Well, there's the answer. They were all on the final table of the Dortmund EPT last year.
And that time, Andreas Højvold edged both Rabe and Ruthenberg. So whose scalp do you think those two players are looking for right now?
Revenge in the air here in Baden. The blinds are posted, 1,500 and 3,000. Every player posting the running NC of 300. We've still got Julian Thu at the table.
And he's happier than anyone to be in the money right now because he made a promise to himself that before he turned 40 years old, he was going to be debt-free.
Under the gun from Julian.
He's in the money.
And he's $20,000 short on his goal, and it's 2 weeks before he turns 40.
I'd be quite happy to reach the age of 39 and just have $20,000 left on my mortgage. Oh, there's a familiar face. Daniel Mangus of Spain. He played in London recently, and we saw him do this a lot, moving all in. He's got a big hand, though, pocket kings.
Julian Thu is not getting off this hand. He's going to call, and it's going to call quite quick, I think.
70.
And Julian does have the chips to spare as well. Although, it's going to cost him about half his stack.
Exactly.
Well, what I like about Mangus' play is the quickness of which he announced all-in. It sounded like ace-king or a middle pair.
70,000 all-in. That means 60,000 more for Julian.
He's stacking up and he's going to call. There's no way he's getting away from this hand.
Taking his time, isn't he?
He is, but I can't see him folding this right now.
And sure enough, there is the call, and Daniel Mangus will be delighted when he sees
Julian
his massive favorite with his pocket king.
Shows us two checks.
And looks like Daniel the situations are going to be reversed. Kings. If Mangus doubles up through Julian Thu, their chip stacks will kind of go back to front.
That would leave Julian Thu in big trouble chip-wise.
Here comes the flop.
So far, so good.
Six, three.
Only two outs for Julian Thu to hit and two cards to come. And there's a jack on the turn.
Second time we've seen Julian Thu get lucky on the turn. First the set of eights, now the set of jacks. Daniel Mangus looking for a king on the river or his tournament's over.
It's a 10.
Nope, the luck is with Julian Thu today. Daniel Mangus eliminated in 24th place. At least he made the money.
At least he made the money. And Julian Thu, the first time he got lucky on a bad play, this time he just got lucky on a pretty self-played play.
At least Daniel Mangus has got a bad beat story to bore everyone with at the bar.
Second time today, yeah?
I don't know what that means.
I don't think you want to know what that means.
But if you're new to poker and you don't know what beats what, here's a simple guide. If no one's got anything else, the high card decides, then it's a pair, then two pairs, and then the hands just get better and better. So once you've mastered the basics of Hold'em, you might want to explore the game a bit further. And with a plethora of poker literature on the market these days, where do you start?
There's really two kinds of poker literature. There are strategy books, such as Super System, which is arguably the most famous of the classic strategy literature. The other category is the histories about the game, which I think are much more fun to read. I think the two best histories of poker are Biggest Game in Town by Al Alvarez and Big Deal by Tony Hold'em.
Many a famous poker pro has turned their hand to writing, but it's Dawe Brunson's Super System, which is universally acknowledged as the greatest poker strategy bible of all time. The books also inspired another great man of the cloth to pen his influential contribution.
The reason I started writing the book was actually for a chapter in Dawe Brunson's Super System, but by the time I got done writing my chapter, it would have been too big to put in the book.
But Ace on the River is not for the faint-hearted beginner.
My book is aimed more at people who are professional poker players or aspiring to be professional poker players. A lot of people who aspire to be professionals really don't have what it takes, and I have a lot of warnings for them. Hopefully there's a lot of wisdom there that I've learned over the years, and most of the wisdom comes from mistakes I've made rather than my successes.
But can reading really improve your game?
No, I don't think poker literature has necessarily that high a place. Many of the successful players haven't read most of the titles, but it's just another weapon in your arsenal.
And with all that reading, surely there's no time left to play. And this is what Barry does when he gets knocked out of a tournament. The player who takes his chips gets a free signed copy of Ace on the River. This happened on day two of the EPT Barden. Barry went. It was Andreas Kraus who got the book, but he doesn't actually want it. Handing it over to Ted Lawson, who's delighted to get the book. Not quite sure what's going through Andreas's mind. Maybe he's already got it. Maybe he's not a Barry Greenstein fan, but a bizarre move. So back to our feature table. Blinds 1,500, 3,000. Everyone in the money now. It takes the pressure off for some players, but obviously it's about getting to the final table. It's about the big money, isn't it?
Well, yeah, but I think that people are now viewing the big money, the first, second, third price, and they're going to start taking more chances once they kind of like clear that little bubble and they're in the money.
Alan Smurfit here with his World Series of Poker bracelet. Not going to play this one.
Well, it still takes him 10 seconds to fold his King Deuce.
Andreas Højvold also folding. So action on Manfred Hammer of Germany. Another German, Sebastian Ruthenberg, one of the chip leaders. And with Queen 10, he's going to raise it.
That's a nice racing hand in late position.
8,100 from Sebastian Ruthenberg.
Julian Thu's folded, so it's Gunnar Rabe. The Swede has 9-7 offsuit.
And unfortunately for Rabe here, he doesn't have the chips to make a move with 9-7 right now, and he quickly realizes it and lets it go.
So just the big blind, Dennis Kallo of Hungary. And he has got a hand, pocket eights.
Well, even though Kallo only has pocket eights, if he were to re-race here, he'd probably get Ruthenberg off, but he decides to just call, see a flop.
So two over cards against a pocket pair, going to the flop. Ruthenberg looking to hit a queen or a 10. And that's what happens.
Queen of diamonds, six of diamonds, another six of spades. Dennis is first to act.
Kallo only has one overcard to his ace. I thought he may be tempted to do something there, but
does Sebastian.
Interesting, Sebastian also checked. Is he hoping to entice a bet out of Dennis on the turn?
Well, he's most likely going to get one
Dennis
here.
Dennis bets out 15,000.
A raise now from Ruthenberg.
Sebastian calls.
No, just a call.
Deciding to play this rather slowly.
Keep the pot manageable.
River card.
The final card
Five of hearts.
Changes nothing. It's queens and sixes against eights and sixes.
Dennis checks.
Well, there was also a missed flush draw here. There were two diamonds on the board, and if Ruthenberg comes out betting, it's not to... I mean, it's quite likely that Kahlo may actually call with his eights here. Ruthenberg is here sitting,
checks too.
Considering to value bet, it decides not to.
Yeah, they check it down. And Ruthenberg will see that the queens are good.
You'll also see that Kahlo had the kind of hand where he could have value bet and got paid.
It's a quite timid play and maybe a missed opportunity to make a few more chips. The action continues here on the EPT in a couple of minutes' time.
It takes more than just good luck to win an EPT event, although of course every little bit helps. I mean, just ask Julian Thew. No, really, it takes a lot more than that. It takes heart, it takes self-assurance, it takes a really good poker face. I'm just going to leave the analysis to the experts, I think, and have a bit of a drink. It's hard work, you know. No, seriously, like, you guys, back to the tables.
Let's go to the outer tables, because Thierry Vandenberghe has gone all in. And it looks as though he's getting a call from Peter Gould.
One time, please, one time. Yes.
You have aces.
Of course I have aces.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So, aces for Thierry Vandenberghe and ace king for Peter Gould.
Good luck. I have
a Gould's going to need a lot of luck against those aces. And he's hit a queen and a 10, so he now has a straight draw. Looking for a jack on the river. It's not to be. Thierry Vandenberghe's aces do stand up. So he will double up through Peter Gould. Look at the relief on his face.
If you've taken too many beats with aces, you feel like they're going to come every single time.
So back to our feature table. And the blinds have gone up. 2,000, 4,000. Running ante of 400. 8,800 in the pot. Before anyone looks at their cards.
And the old cliche is coming too true. The price of poker has gone up.
Then as Kahlo is first to speak, and he's got King Deuce, and he's not going to play it.
Did you see the anticipation in which he looked for that king after seeing a deuce first?
Action folded to Andreas Højvold.
Højvold decides to fold.
Now it's Manfred Hammer.
Interesting to see the hands around like this. You see how few hands are really good starting hands when you look at a full ring table.
In late position, on the button with pocket sixes, Bastian Ruthenberghe raised it up to 11,000. And the small blind, Julian Thew's got ace 10.
If this was raised from early position, Julian Thew wouldn't have thought about it. Right now he's looking at a rather aggressive player on the button who's decided to race. I think he thinks his ace 10 is probably good here, or he wants to punish Ruthenberghe a little bit.
Julian makes a re-raise.
Re-raises.
30,000 total here for Julian Thew.
And there's an ace jack. Now, here's an interesting decision. Gunnar Rabe has a better hand than Thew, but.
And Gunnar Rabe has a chip stack where he only has two options, fold or all in. He knows that Ruthenberghe could have raced with anything on the button. He also knows that Julian Thew would hit back with a lot of hands that he beats right now, like ace 10, for example. And he's thinking maybe he's getting such a great price that this is the time he wants to just push in the chips. And that is a poor play here by Rabe.
He calls Julian Thew's raise, and now the decision is back on Sebastian Ruthenberghe.
And what happens now is that Ruthenberghe can call. If Rabe had moved all in here, that would have meant that Ruthenberghe was so scared of Julian Thew, had a big chip stack behind there, that he would have been out of the pot, and he would have had a coin, and Thew may have thought he had to call, but by just calling, bad play by Rabe.
And three of diamonds.
Julian Thew.
Check from Julian.
Checks.
Action is on Gunnar. And about this 92,000.
You still have one more chance to push your chips in, Robert, but you should have done it earlier.
He's making the move. And of course, Rosenberg does still have the best hand, but it's hard for him to think he has with that king on board.
Well, if he was heads up here with Robert, it would have been a quite easy call, I would say, for Rosenberg. But since he has Julian Thu behind there, and he doesn't know where he has to right now, he has to lay it down.
Sebastian passes.
And Julian Thu can't possibly call.
Those remaining chips are...
Well, he knows that Robert would push with a lot of hands here. And the only question he's asking himself, did I beat Robert preflop, or does he have a king? I mean, or do I have the odds to call to hit an ace or a 10? He doesn't know his ace is not good to hit either. I think we'll see eventually that Julian Thu realizes that it's too much to pay in what very likely is only a 3-outer, either the ace or the 10.
Giving it some serious thought.
But Robert would have gotten this call easily if it was preflop and he decided to push, whereas I believe that Rothenberg would have been forced to fold. This game is so much easier when you can see their whole cards.
Well, he's made the call. I'm very surprised about that.
Well, he's thinking eventually he's getting too good of a price, and Rabe is thinking he's out of this tournament right now, and he's going to be very excited when he sees what Julian Thu turns over.
He's got him dominated. Julian Thu's ace is not live. He's going to need to hit a 10 on the turn or river.
And did you see how Rabe turned to the table to see? He didn't hit that, did he? No, he didn't. I'm ahead.
But he's seen Julian Thu get lucky in a fair few hands.
There are three tens that could help Julian Thu right now, and he's gonna need them.
One behind.
Turn card.
Yes, tough spot.
Is it eight of
turn card doesn't help Julian.
Could it be that Julian Thu does not hit his one single card? Well, three in this case, but it's only one that looks like help, and it holds up here for Gunnar Rabe.
Gunnar stays in the tournament.
He stays in the tournament, and he doubles up. Nearly 165,000 in chips now. He's a contender.
And he got the exact same result as he would have if he went all in preflop.
Look who's kicking himself.
Because he could be a stocking gun. Yeah, it looked like, looked a little bit like... 50-50, he's either going to hand or he's...
Hands I should have played by Sebastian Rothenberg.
You're overcard.
Yeah.
Too much in there. Too much in there.
Well, they're doing the analysis here, and Julian was exactly correct when he said it could have been a stop and go, because that's what Gunnar Rabe tried there. He tried to call and then hope that other people missed the flop so he could push on the flop.
So now you know what a stop and go is, but be careful, kids, before you try it at home.
Found it.
Sebastian Rothenberg looking at an ace king.
Better than sixes.
Looks prettier.
Raising
11,200.
Just over 11,000. It's been folded to Dennis Kallo, Hungarian player. Looking down at his hand. Five, six offsuit, that'll go in the muck. So just the blinds. Alan Smurfit has posted the small blind.
Actually, he only posted his bracelet.
Yeah. How many chips is that worth?
I think most people at the table would trade the chips they had for that bracelet.
Now here's a question. You're sitting in the small blind with ace 10 suited. You're facing a raise.
11-2.
With a chip stack, Alan Smurfit has fold.
Of course.
Well, in this instance, he's decided to flat call.
I would.
Andreas is in the big blind, and he'll give up the ace deuce.
Well, at least he had an ace. It's a lesser chance the Smurfit hits the sole ace and has to stick around here with Rothenberg. But he doesn't have the chip stack to flat call with that. I mean, you could at least justify an all-in, even though he would have gotten punished even harder. But hey, he got the flop he was hoping for.
Yeah, he's got four diamonds. He's got the nut flush draw.
So
six of clubs.
Now will be a good time for him to move all in, to make the semi-bluff.
Yeah, it looks as though he has about 56,000 chips. I would say at least loud and clear, I'm pot committing myself to this, because there's no way you're getting away from this, Alan, and Put your chips in now. Don't get it check at least.
Couldn't see very clear.
Put your glasses on.
All in.
He's made the move.
Goes all in.
Power yes, poker from Alan Smurfit.
Well, as you can see, it's actually a pretty clear coin flip right now, and it's hard for Ruthenberg to call. I mean, he may as well have a little pair that he was just looking for a low flop and would push in if he got that low flop.
I'm sure Sebastian knows that Alan doesn't mess about. It's very rare for him to make a move with no hand, and probably thinks ace-king is not good enough, and he will muck it.
Well, Smurfit made a pretty poor pre-flop call, and he played it perfectly when he got the flush draw.
Getting aggressive when he needed to. And raking those chips.
You'll see it on TV.
And he's giving nothing away. Alan Smurfit, a very successful businessman. He's now retired and he's playing tournament poker. Been on the circuit for 4 years. And of course, over the summer, he won that World Series bracelet, which he now uses as his lucky card protector.
At least the other players has a full display of it. Well, he's first to act right now and he's looking down at a six and an ace. It takes a while before we see both of Smurfit's cards.
Being bothered by a fly.
Flies.
They need one of those blue things. Do you know what I mean? In the casino? Those lamps that go and attract bugs.
And you get to see the action the whole time when you're bored with your 5-9 offset and you get to see it bzzz.
Get to see him fried.
Well, actually, there's quite a big of a bug problem at the feature table here in Baden. All the players seem to be frustrated by the flies running around, but the only person who's protected from that is Julian Thu, because he's brought his own little fan that is sitting behind.
He's checking his option.
So it's an unraised pot, blind on blind.
Flop is king, four and three.
And it's Dennis Carlo who's hit here.
Check from
and he's decided to check it.
Well, that gives Rob quite a few draws. Spades. He has a nice flush draw and he has an open and a straight draw.
Three spades are now on the board.
He's betting it.
Gunnar bets 5,500. Dennis calls.
Carlo will call. He is still in front with your the pair card, of fours. And they hold up. Robert misses Raymond. All of his outs.
Does he have a good enough hand to withstand the race here from Rabe? Well, he never had to see it. And four is good.
Checked at the river.
They check it down and the pair of fours will take in the chips. And a bet on the end there from Rabe might have been enough to take it down. I mean,
it's hard to say. I mean, in a blind battle like that, you know that your pair may hold quite often, especially with that many draws on the board. So I think Rob actually made a good decision just to check there. Give up on it, he didn't hit anything more.
You don't lose what you don't put in the middle. Action's on Manfred Hammer. He's got 5-4 offsuit. And folded around to Dennis Carlo.
This time is Dennis in the small blind that he
once
calls.
Again we see the small blind just filling up the big blind and getting what is likely to be a blind battle here. Ace 9.
The big blind sits Alan, who announces
Alan
a
Smurfit
race.
Alan says no free flops.
20,000 more to go.
60.
Now what would you do if you were in Carlo's position? Would you call, hoping to hit the flop? Out of position?
I would
so much.
Maybe just lay it down. It's no point getting involved there and looking for a hit. But then again, if he does choose to call and hits either a king or an eight, it's most likely that if he checks, he's going to get a bet against, then he can take it. But it's just no point right now for Carlo.
He says he doesn't want to gamble. He's followed your advice.
Well, of course, you could hear that voice just speaking reason in the background.
I had a better one, for sure.
For sure.
You'll see on TV.
It's becoming Alan Smurfit's catchphrase, and we'll continue to see the action on TV after this short break here on the European Poker Tour.
Good line. Good line.
EPT has come to Baden in Austria, and on our outer tables, this is Jiří Vaček. He took a big hit a few hands back. He's now all in blind, and he is out, losing to Hans Eskilsson. He takes home €12,860 for 23rd place.
And the former Swedish football star takes out another player.
Back to our feature table. Line still 2,000, 4,000. Actions on Andreas Højvold, he folds. Manfred Hammer, originally from Germany, now lives here in Austria. Also not gonna play this one.
Ruthenberg is gonna play though. He picks up ace, queen, unsuited.
He's been picking up some nice hands.
Well, yeah, he's been playing pretty well here. And I think that the table views him as rather active because he's been picking up so many hands. And it's one of the problems with picking up too many hands. You can't start playing the fun alternative hands because you already have such a loose image at the table.
Action is on Dennis in the small blind.
King 10 of clubs.
It's fun. Cool. Something Kahlo wants to see a flop with.
He's got money invested already, so he'll call from the small blind.
But it's also scary because it's a hand that if he hits is likely dominated, and sitting out of position here, so it's harder to acquire that information, but it doesn't seem to matter much to Kahlo right now.
Alan Smurfit folds from the big blind, so we are heads up to the flop, and as you say, Sverre, Kahlo will be the first to speak once the first three community cards are dealt.
I must admit, I was a little impressed with Smurfit there. It only took him 10 seconds to fold the 7 deuce offsuit.
King and 7 of hearts, queen of spades.
Carlo's hit top pair, Rothenberg's hit second pair.
Turn card,
they both check.
Spades.
River changes, sorry, the turn changes nothing.
Right now, it's Ruthenberg is left with no information. He checked the flop, and he's going to have to hang here.
Sebastian calls.
A bet and a call.
River card.
That's the river card.
Nine of
still
hearts.
No change.
Check from both players. So
they both check it down. Maybe they're worried about the prospect of a flush.
Yeah, it's a situation where Kahlo doesn't really know if his best. Then there's a scary card coming on the river as well with the heart because it was check on the flop.
Sebastian marks his hand.
And I think Ruthenberg was ecstatic to see Kahlo check in front because then he didn't have to call a value bet there.
Kahlo stacks up more chips. Hungarian doing very well in this tournament. Must be one of the chip leaders now.
Well, that's what he's aiming for.
Everyone looking for a seat at the final table, looking for a chance to win the big money.
Hammer time.
Pocket queens.
Uh-oh.
Raise to 20,000 from Manfred Hammer.
Is that pocket jacks for Ruthenberg?
And I think we can tell Ruthenberg he's got to pray just to make it today.
Call.
One more MC Hammer gag and I'm going to slap you.
Well, one thing's for sure, Hammer is a massive favorite now and Ruthenberg is in trouble.
Just the blinds. Alan Smurfit folds. Andreas Højvold will fold as well.
Sebastian called. All other players folded.
So.
Ruthenberg is now dreading a nine-high flop, and that's what he gets.
Disaster.
And I can tell you this much. If Hammer goes out betting, this is going to be expensive.
25,000.
Do you reckon Ruthenberg will raise here?
If he chooses to call pre-flop, he has to be willing to involve some chips when he gets his dream flop. And right now, I think that
all in.
Ruthenberg is going to do something, and he does. He moves all in.
He's all in.
And it's enough to put Hammer all in, because he's got fewer chips. But with pocket queens,
there's around
and that flop,
thousand of chips.
It's not that tough a decision, is it?
Well, it's too late in the tournament to fold this hand right now, Hammer. And he's scared. I mean, of course he's scared, but there's also the flush draw on the board, and he has to call here right now. I mean, he's thinking, what can Ruthenberg be sitting with that I actually beat? He can have tens, he can have jacks. He can also have kings or aces, just flat calling preflop, but he has to call here still.
Manfred requests to count the chips.
Well, Manfred wants to know exactly how much Sebastian has, and the answer is, because we've got the figures on our screen, that it's enough to put Hammer all in. So his tournament would be on the line if he made the call. And really, he's just got to do that analysis, hasn't he? He's got to think, what is he likely to have called my raise pre-flop and now moved all in?
Sebastian has 145,000 in front of him.
Well, he's thinking he can have nines, that would beat me. More. He can have tens and jacks, that would I beat. He could have kings and aces, which again would beat me, and he could have the flush draw. That's the big chance that he was sitting with a flush draw here, something ace-queen suited, ace-jack suited, something like that, and
he's
that's
folded.
A poor lay-down hammer.
He's folded!
I can understand that lay-down early in the tournament, but this is much too late to make that lay-down.
That's incredible. Absolutely incredible. Ruthenberg got away with it. We thought those jacks were going to spell disaster for him.
Well, obviously, we have the advantage of seeing both players' cards, but even if you can't see your opponent's hand, that is a very tight fold.
Oof, it's such a poor play. He is now, I mean, he chooses to invest too much money at this point in the tournament to fold queens. And of course, he's scared. There's the chance that he flat call with aces, there's a flat chance he flat call with kings, but you know, you reach the point in every tournament where you have to take chances. And right now, there was even a flush draw on the board, which Ruthenberg easily could have had two overs and a flush draw.
And it's almost like, what kind of flop was he looking for? One with a queen on it, maybe two queens on it?
He's been flat called pre-flop. He could have the aces or kings. There's also so likely that he has the jacks or nine that he has the flush draw. I think it's a very, very poor play by Manfred Hammer.
Yeah, and a useful lesson if you're just taking up the game. In a tournament like this, you cannot win, you can't progress if you fold queens in a situation like that.
Let's journey to the outer tables briefly. Bit of jousting between a couple of Scandies here. David Sonlin and August Betts, and looks like August is going to take that one. Always happy to see Norway beat Sweden. I can see the smile on your face, Sverre.
Well, it's a stronger rivalry than people may think.
Of course, no friends at the poker table.
Well, we feel sorry for them now. We found oil, they didn't.
Action here on Alan Smurfit. It does take a long time, you're right.
Just looking at the cards is what takes the longest, because he looks at one and he's making it quite an entertainment factor looking at the second one to see if it matches anything.
I think it's been folded round to the blinds. Sebastian Ruthenberg in the small blind.
I'm quite sure Alan Smurfit has the long version of dealing the cards on PokerStars when he plays. He wants to see one by one.
An unraised pot. It's a pair of jacks for Ruthenberg, a pair of eights blind. For Julian Thu. They both check. Now two pairs for Julian Thu. Again, it's the turn card that makes his hand.
Well, he's going to get paid a little bit by Ruthenberg now. He's not laying it down. He's not going to raise this, I believe, but he's going to flat call.
10 and 8. Julian bet 6,000 and Sebastian calls.
A 4 now would be the trouble card for Thu.
King.
He can't like that.
Well, at least it slowed down the action for Ruthenberg here.
Sebastian bets 10,000.
Half the pot, trying to slow down the action, saying, I want a showdown. Thu is not going to lay down. I know he's scared of the queen, but he's not going to lay it down. Julian knows just as well as other seasoned players that more often than not, you're going to have positive odds by calling in those situations, even though there is the chance that he has the queen right now.
There's the call. Cards go on their back, and Julian Thu will take it down. Yeah. He knew he was in front until that river card, and then he didn't know where he was.
Well, the reason the river is also bad is it doesn't just fill one straight draw, it fills an up and down straight draw, because the nine would also give a straight draw to a queen, which would have explained why Ruthenberg could be hanging there. But it's if Ruthenberg bets full pot there, he's going to get Julian to throw that hand away.
On to the next hand. Dennis Carlo is under the gun, first to speak. He's got one ace. What's the other one?
Ooh, it's the Smurfit pull, and he has to fold with a seven.
An early position. Can't be affording to play those weak aces. Smurfit folding Jack Deuce. Ace four of hearts for Andreas Hoivold. Excuse me. He's not got many chips left, has he?
He is sitting with about 40,000-50,000.
And with the blinds as they are, he's kind of in an all in or fold situation. All he's in. Chosen to move all in, just under 47,000.
Raise all in from Andreas Hoivold.
Well, it's a risky move, but it's a move you got to make after a while when you get too short here. It's 8,800 to pick up in the middle, and that being a pretty large increase here for Andreas Hoivold.
He'd be quite happy to pick up the blinds and antes here.
It's probably the last round where you can get all the semi-decent, not too great hands to fold.
Oh, he's not going to get him to fold with kings. Don't prolong it, Gunnar. Just throw the chips in.
I thought that was nice, nicely paced by Gunnar Robert. He didn't drag on too long.
Ace four of hearts.
So it's a showdown with five cards to come, and Andreas Hoivold's best hope really is to hit an ace or running hearts.
It's best time I've ever had today, so.
The kings, 2-1 favorite.
Really, but thank you. I need it.
We'll see the flop.
Former EPT winner Hoivold is in danger of being eliminated.
Eight, six,
but that gives him a straight draw with a seven.
Gotcha draw. Straight draw for Andreas.
For a seven. Or an ace.
Turn card. A nine.
Well, now he would only get a chop if the seven was to come.
Next card.
So really, looking for that ace, it doesn't come.
Number 22 of this
we say goodbye
tournament.
To Andreas Hoivold, winner from of
Norway.
EPT Dortmund in Season 3, out in 22nd place
of 60 minutes.
In EPT Baden in Season 4.
The right move
really
gets punished.
Andreas Hoivold has gone out here in Baden in the money. Now, we also saw you in Barcelona earlier this year, and of course you won at Dortmund in the last season. So you're going for two titles?
Of course I am. I was hoping to get one more here, but didn't go that way.
But you will be trying again, won't you? We're going to see you back here on the tour, going for that second EPT title, because no one's done two events.
My plan is to be the first.
Well, good luck with that. Was there a point in the tournament tonight where things started to turn for you, that they just weren't working?
No, it was no point. I really was totally carded all day. So ace four all suited looked like a wonder for me. I really got really bad cards. So.
Well, hopefully you'll get much better cards in the next time we see you in the next EPT. And well done for getting this far.
Thank you.
Well, as said, Dennis Carlo looked like he was one of the chip leaders. In fact, he is the chip leader right now. 254,000. Close behind, though, is David Sonlin of Sweden with 251,000 in chips. A few other familiar names still in there as well. And here's a familiar face. It's August Spetz. He's all in with the pocket rockets against Victor Goosen's pocket sevens. Five cards to come. So far, so good for Augie. Will it be a seven on the river? Nope, the aces stand up. Our most cheerful EPT regular stays in the game. Do with a haircut though, couldn't he?
So we're down to 21 players here in Baden, but that's all we can fit into this show. So join us next time when we find out who makes it into the final eight and into the really big money.
Yes, 21 players remain in action here at the Casino Baden. We're off for a break. I'll allow you one more MC Hammer gag, and that's it.
But James, you can't touch this.
Why not? I thought we were friends. Join us next time on the European Poker Tour.